Welcome to a little conversation that we're going to have, me and Mr. Drew. You guys know Mr. Drew as English teacher here, as the moderator of CS1, many other things. But you might not know that he's also an author. And I have a copy of a book, which is a collection of essays, of which Mr. Drew is the author of one of the chapters. And the theme of the book, or the topic of the book, is the 1966 Batman TV show, of which I'm a huge fan. And I know Mr. Drew's a huge fan. He has a podcast about the show. And we're even here in the glorious Batcave. So Mr. Drew, tell us a little bit about your relationship, your history with the Batman TV show.
Well, I like to say that I am what I like to call a first generation syndication baby. I was born just as the Batman 66 series was ending in 1968. Okay. So it wasn't for maybe a couple of years after that I did first catch it, but I like to still call myself that first wave of syndication because the show immediately went into syndication, aired here locally for many years. Those who know the New York market and such.
Channel 11.
Channel 11, yeah. WPIX, yeah, for many, many years. So every day after school, I would be rushing home, get my homework done first. That was my mother's big thing, and then you could watch whatever you want. So I flew through homework as quickly as I could. To sit down and watch The Adventures of Superman, The Lone Ranger, and then two episodes of Batman every day. And just something about that show spoke to me in terms of the quality of the character, more so than even The Lone Ranger and Superman did.
Mm-hmm. What is that, when you say the quality of the character, what is character?
Because, well, when I say character, I mean it's a character, well, he's the kind of character who always does what's right. Always. I mean, there are moments where you question Superman. Even in that TV series, there's an episode of Superman where he actually leaves a group of villains on top of a mountaintop because they've learned his identity. Mm-hmm. He leaves them at a cabin. He says, "I'll be back with food and such." They decide to make it a run for it, and they start climbing down the mountain, and unfortunately, they fall to their deaths.
Oh, my God.
Superman allowed that. So, you know, there are gray areas with Superman. There are even gray areas sometimes with the Lone Ranger. Batman was always the good guy. He always did what was right, and no matter what, would never give in to temptation unless he was drugged, which was a common theme in many of the episodes. He seems to get drugged a lot.
And so as a boy, this quality of goodness, it spoke to you.
It spoke to me. It spoke to me because there was a lot of things I had been seeing on television where, and I was capable of making the distinction, but there was just something about it that other television shows, again, those gray areas, I would enjoy them, but there wasn't just something there to latch onto to connect. And it's funny because, as you say, I have the podcast. Over the years, I've been doing the podcast since 2015.
Wow.
Yeah. And we've gone through every episode reviewing it. Now we're looking at the pop culture influences and such. Adam West, the star, died 2 years ago now. Mm-hmm. And I remember the day that he did die, I felt like a little piece of me died as well. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just a simple matter of, an actor that I admired. And what was funny was, because I talk about it so much, I don't know, I started getting texts from some of my coworkers here going, I'm sorry for your loss. And I'm like, was it my loss? And I thought to myself, maybe it was my loss in a way that it's like losing a family member. And then in talking about it with other fans, we came to the conclusion Adam West was almost like a father we didn't have and maybe we needed in some ways. I mean, we all love our dads, but our dads had their flaws. Yeah. Adam West and Batman never had their flaws. Mm. So there you have Adam West as your father figure and Burt Ward as your son. Not your son, I'm sorry, your brother.
Your brother,
your brother.
Yeah. That's amazing. I mean, that's a long-term relationship, right? From the time you're a little boy through young adult to your adult years.
Yes.
And so I could understand why people would reach out to you and say, my condolences, you know.
And I have to say, as corny as it might sound, because there are plenty of fans who say, I became a teenager, I lost, I still like Batman, but I knew that was corny. I never, ever lost interest in the show. I would want any opportunity, 11 would let it go, and then they'd rest it for a while and then bring it back. Mm-hmm. When the Michael Keaton movie came out, to me, I was more thrilled that we were getting Batman back on TV than I was about the Michael Keaton movie.
Right. See, so this is an interesting little historical thing. So growing up in the 80s, Michael Keaton's Batman coming out was that reason for the show to be on TV again, yep, in syndication. You use that word syndication. Probably some of our younger viewers don't know the word syndication. Can you explain that really quick?
Well, basically, you have your major television networks and markets and such, like ABC, CBS, and NBC. But then you also have other smaller stations, like Channel 5. Well, actually, Channel 5 now here in New York is also a Fox station, but WOR, Channel 11, WPIX. And what would happen is that they would purchase most of the time rerun material, although they did also purchase original material as well, that would run in syndication. And because of that, it would run at various times. So here in New York, Batman was on 4 o'clock and 4:30 every day. But maybe if you went out to LA, Batman would be on at 8 in the morning, gotcha, thanks to their syndication deal. They would buy the package and then they would program it as they saw fit, whereas your networks always have the programming on at the same time.
Gotcha. Okay, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah, so for me as a kid, my introduction to Batman really was this TV show. And then when I was, you know, maybe 8 or 9 years old, the movie came out in the theaters. And shortly after that, in 1992, Batman the Animated Series came out.
Yes.
And I would say for guys my age and a little bit younger and a little bit older probably too, right around our age, that animated show really became probably like what the Batman 66 show was for your generation, for us.
Yes.
You know, and that was a darker kind of more Art Deco kind of take on Batman. Tell us about Batman 66 is a fun place. It's a colorful place. You have colorful bad guys, and it's the show is a lot of fun. Tell us about that.
Well, Adam West has always said, you know, the animated series, the Michael Keaton movies, Christian Bale movies and such, those are all the Dark Knight. And he always liked to refer to himself as the Bright Knight.
Okay.
It's a world where the characters are all just a little either too good to be true in terms of their goodness in some ways, and maybe that's the cynic in me now in 2020, or even when they're bad, they're never so bad that they do anything. I mean, I say that horrific, but then there are two-part episodes in every episode. Batman and Robin are always caught in a death trap. So,
yeah, yeah.
And some of them are actually pretty horrific if you really think about it. Whether it's Robin on a spinning mobile while blades are swinging at him and they're supposed to be cutting him apart and such. But you never got the feeling that they really were ever in danger. It was more about watching and seeing how clever Batman was getting out of the traps and but it never ever got to a point where you felt nervous for them. You just were excited for them and knew that they were going to save the day, that that good would always prevail, even in the worst possible moments. And the worst possible moments were always the death trap, you know. As William Dozier, the producer, who also was the narrator of the show, would say at the beginning of the second episode, but wait, the worst is yet to come.
Right. Okay, you just referenced it. This TV show was broken into two parts. Tell us about that.
So what happened was that when the show was created, it was actually thought it was going to be an hour-long series.
Okay.
But they did test audiences with it as an hour-long. That didn't work. Then they tried, because they were knowing that they were doing this as a sort of takeoff on also this 1940s serials, they thought, all right, well, let's do it as an hour, but we're going to do it in 15-minute chapters throughout the hour. And there'll always be some sort of hook at the 15-minute mark, which would be where you would have your cliffhanger ending.
Gotcha.
And then go on with that. Again, they did it with the test market. Didn't work. So then they decided to break it up into the two parts. But what's interesting is throughout the whole process, because many times people say, oh, Batman, that was a funny show. And in fact, if you ever look at TV Guide listings for the show, they refer to it as a comedy. They don't say adventure. It's comedy.
Right. Yeah.
And so they tried everything because every audience reaction to the show was always negative. In fact, there are stories that say, based on the ratings of the audience that would view and rate it for them before it went to air, it got one of the worst ratings ever.
Oh, wow.
It's interesting to see. So they put laugh tracks. The laugh track didn't work. At certain points, they even put up little signs saying, you can laugh. And people were like, why? And they really thought they had a bomb on their hands. They really thought this was going to go off. Adam West had faith in it the whole time. It was so funny. He signed on to it knowing, he said, this is so smart and so intelligent and so hip and maybe their audience market was all wrong because they got desperate. They were supposed to wait until the fall of 66 to premiere the show. But ABC was tanking with all their programming was just awful. They couldn't win for anything on the ratings. And they said, what have we got to lose? Put Batman up there. And, and in the middle of January, cold winter's night, Batman went on the air. They did heavy promotion. And they thought, all right, well, we'll wait. It's going to be another dud.
You're one of those who just can't get enough of Batman. Help is here.
Hey, Jefferson and 12.
Hold tight. Bat turn.
Surrender. We've got you, Bank Bandit.
I order you to surrender.
I hope this doesn't depress you.
Sensational. Batman, watch out, those mummies.
Sometimes I think people expect too much of us, Batman.
They have a right to expect it.
But we're only human.
There. Feel better? It's only temporary relief, we know. But the next episode is just a few bat hours away.
But the college kids clicked.
Wow.
That was the big audience. Before the kids, it was actually the college kids. They thought it was the craziest thing, and they were talking about it the next day, and then the ratings again went even higher for the second episode, and then the parents and the kids started watching it, and that's when you saw this was a show for everybody. You know, for the kids, it had the Biff Bang Pow, but for the adults, it had some sometimes risque humor, sometimes very highbrow humor. For the dads, there were attractive girls running around. And for the moms, they liked Adam West and Burt Ward, found them very handsome. So everybody had a stake in watching it.
Yeah, I was just home the other day, and my mom and I watched the first episode and the second episode, which are that two-parter. And I said to my mom, I said, Mom, do you think Adam West is handsome? And she said, oh, yes, very handsome. Everyone thought he was very handsome, you know, debonair, you know.
Very debonair. Well, he had been courted for a brief time there, but he turned them down to be James Bond.
Oh, wow.
When Sean Connery had stepped aside before George Lazenby stepped in, they went to Adam West and said, we want you to be the next James Bond. And he was like, absolutely not. He goes, it's a British property. He goes, I could fake a British accent, but I just can't fake that essential Britishness of it all. You know, even he knew his limits. So they went to an Australian.
And then back to,
well, because they went back, and just as a quick thing, they went back because George Lazenby turned them down for a second movie. They were all set. They were ready. They were like, you're the man. And frankly, I know we're getting off topic a little bit, but like if you ever get a chance, watch On Her Majesty's Secret Service. It's another one of these gems that people don't give enough credit to.
It's the only one where James Bond gets married.
Yes.
Right? Very interesting movie, yeah. Okay, so back on topic.
Well, bring it back to Batman. Adam West was always saying he was part of the three Bs of the 60s. Beatles, Bond, and Batman.
Wow. Oh, that's pretty cool. I never heard that before.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So we've talked about the show. Big fans of the show. You've got your podcast. And then we come to this book.
Yes.
So there's a friend of yours, edited the book, asked you to do a chapter. So tell us just more about the book as a whole, and then we'll talk about your chapter.
Well, Jim Beard, the editor of the book, had done a book previously called Gotham City 14 Miles, in which he had asked various authors, and this was before I knew him, so maybe I would have been involved. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I had actually pitched him ideas if he was going to do a sequel to that book. But basically, different authors had pitched him ideas about different aspects of Batman, whether it was the music of the show or the villains or you know, how a script came about, like somebody did something on that, or even just as something as simple as the title card effects that would be put up there, the Biff, the Bang, the Pow, and all that. So, and it was very well received. And as I say, he was thinking about doing a sequel, but he never felt that there was enough material that it could match what he did with Gotham City, but he still felt there was more to say about the show. So then he said, well, what if I do a season-by-season look at the series? Not an episode guide, because there's plenty of books out there that do episode guides. He didn't want to do that, but he wanted his authors to break down a particular episode from their perspective.
Okay.
So he started reaching out. He reached out to me because Jim had been on the podcast, and that's how we became friends. He reached out to Keith DeCandido, who's also Spellman Class of 86, yes. and has written about Batman for Tor.com. And various other authors and such. And he basically said, I'll give you the episode, but I'm not going to tell you how to write about it. It's up to you how you want to approach it. So there's all these different approaches, including Jim's, which is very unique because he does it almost in a fictional way, telling the story of a young boy watching that first episode because he took on the first one as the editor. He gets to choose. The boy watching the show for the first time ever and his father watching with him.
And the dad's kind of like humoring him, like, okay, we'll watch the show.
Right.
But then the dad's into it too. And that speaks to what you said, like college kids liked it, children liked it, adults liked it. It played to this really wide audience.
Exactly.
So now tell us, you wrote one of the chapters in the book.
Right. Well,
and you said each author got to take their own kind of take on it. What'd you do?
I did it more from the historical perspective. I think, you know, when Jim had said he wanted us to do a book about the episodes, I thought there's also been a lot written about the episodes. I've done a podcast where we've broken down the episodes.
Yeah.
So I thought to myself, I don't really want to repeat myself here. So I've been doing a lot of research lately into television of the 60s and 70s. I subscribe to a service called newspapers.com, which has you know, tens of thousands of newspapers from around the world all archived that you can readily access and such. So I started digging in to that first year as they were leading up to the premiere of Batman and the announcement of who was going to be appearing as which characters and which villains and such. And getting into why, because my episode is about False Face. They, at the time, couldn't do Two-Face because they felt he was too horrific looking a figure and such. So they, instead they created False Face, a master of disguise. And there was always some mystery around who was the actor that played him. There was also a lot about why his particular female companion, the mole, was given more prominence compared to other ones. So I wanted to do the dive in there. So that's where I approached it from. I looked at it from Myrna Fey, who plays Blaze, his beautiful assistant, as they say, who in her own right could be a villain, you know, on par with the villains as well. Why they were focused on her so much, and it turns out when you look at it,
because that's not always the case, right?
No, not
sometimes
at all.
She's just there.
She's there,
you know,
to say, why is that Joker? Why is that Penguin?
Right.
What are we doing next, Joker? You know, that's her role, and to look pretty. This woman was given a whole lot more to do. She herself was a master of disguise as well, and on par with False Face in terms. The one trapping of the episode, though, is that she falls for Batman's charms, and of course then moves from being the bad guy to being a good guy and working with him throughout the episode. But the actress herself had actually been looked upon as an up-and-coming possible Elizabeth Taylor. She bore a resemblance to her as well when you saw her real hair, because throughout the episode she's sporting the wildest wigs. So I went for the historical approach.
Now, False Face, is that a character that was in the comics or that we see again later in Batman's history?
You don't see him in Batman's history overall. There isn't an issue of the Batman comic book, which the number is eluding me right now, where there is a False Face character who is able to do quick change, but not on the level of False Face. And he also doesn't have this weird mask that False Face wore. In fact, actually, many people complained about False Face. For as much as people said Two-Face was grotesque, they thought that False Face, when he wasn't in disguise, he had this weird-looking plastic mask that made him look, as they said, like a burn victim. He never made a return appearance, which, interestingly enough, that's also part of my argument there. He should have been given that because it's one of the better stories of the first season.
There's something, just to talk about the mask for a minute. When we look at a person, I think we try to get a read on that person, right? Is this somebody I can trust? Are they good? Are they bad? You know, how can I take them? And when you look at somebody and they have a mask like that, you really can't tell. Is this a good person? Is it a bad person? You know, and then maybe that speaks to his character. He's constantly putting on disguises. So who is he? We don't know.
Right.
He's morphing. He's changing. It's interesting, especially because the protagonist of the show wears a mask.
Right.
But as something that throughout Batman's history that comes up is, why does he leave the little space of his mouth exposed? You know, everything else is covered up. And there's all kinds of different theories throughout the history as to why that is.
Right.
Joker thinks it's to mock him. You know, some of the characters, oh, because it points out that he's still human. Different kind of takes. But maybe it allows us to know that he's human and we can trust him. Whereas this character is a little strange, or like we can't really get a read on him.
Well, it's funny you say that, because now as we're recording this, we're still in the middle of the pandemic. And there are times I think it's really a shame we're wearing these because sometimes you can't really tell, even from the eyes of a person, what it is they're exactly feeling, whereas you get that more from the mouth, from the whole face and such. So with Batman having that lower part, at least you know how he feels when he's... And again, that's probably why with Adam West in particular, he's always got, for the most part, a smile on his face.
A little smirk or a smile.
Right?
Yeah, for sure, for sure. I think some people who are familiar with Batman the Animated Series or even like the recent Harley Quinn show would be familiar with Clayface, a character who is an actor who can morph his appearance. Probably kind of maybe a somewhat similar or related kind of character, I would think.
Somewhat similar, but you know, he morphs it physically. It's a condition he has, because, and that's why they call him Clayface. In fact, his entire body, it's not just a matter of changing his facial appearance there. He can make himself look like a woman, you know, he can make himself look like a table if he needs to or something.
Yeah.
Whereas false face, although when they say he's a master, it is incredibly fast, because there's scenes like, for instance, they're in an old abandoned Western town for filmmaking and such.
Mm-hmm.
And at one point, he kind of runs into a building and comes out seconds later as Commissioner Gordon.
Oh, wow.
You know, with the handkerchief, coughing and such, pretending to be, you know, Gordon and such. And it's a really quick change, you know. And we're not talking about, you know, just, again, the face. He's got the outfit, and you're wondering, where did the outfit come from? You know, there's a villain in the Marvel comics called Chameleon, but Chameleon has a projector that allows him to change his appearance. It's all holographic, though. But this is just physically
changing.
And managed to affect enough of a voice that he can fool most people, except Batman.
Right, of course, of course. Now, something we were talking about earlier is, there's a lot of different Batmen out there, right? Mm-hmm. We've got Michael Keaton, we've got a Christian Bale, Ben Affleck, we've got coming up Robert Pattinson's coming out soon as Batman, and we've got this enduring Adam West. How do you fit that all together? How do you, like, an Adam West Batman is very different than a Ben Affleck Batman. Are they all Batmen? What makes an actor, what makes that role essentially Batman?
Well, as we discussed, I mean, for the most part, overall, I'm pretty good with all the men who played the role of Batman, with the exception of, I have my issues with Christian Bale. You know, I just felt that it was all too dark, and I didn't care for the voice and such. I applaud everybody who appreciates it. You know, God bless you. It didn't work for me.
Sure.
I mean, I even liked Ben Affleck. I even like, and we're actually doing this right now, on the podcast, we're going through the 1943 movie serial, where you have, and I'm blanking, Robert Lowry, I think is his name, and he has this thick New England accent.
Okay.
So, you know, he'll be there going, Alfred, Alfred, come in here moments. You know, and he's got that accent. It's a little weird, because you expect Bruce to be a little more polished and such. Mm-hmm. But also remember, 1943, it's only about 3 or 4 years into the comic book. Bruce Wayne hasn't been that well established yet, so you know, he did it as best he could. Jim Beard, who edited that, he had four criteria, and I'm going to probably forget one, but he says, you know, does he balance between Bruce Wayne and Batman equally? You know, if you do that, that's part of what Batman's about. Is he fighting crime? Is that his primary objective? Now, you can argue the different ways he goes about it.
Sure.
But does he fight crime? If he does, then yes, he's Batman.
Mm-hmm.
And now, as I say all that, there's two others in which Jim will be watching this and going, how could you forget? I told you this.
His parents were murdered in
the alley. His parents were murdered in the alley. That's one. Yeah. That is one of his other ones. I mean, because that is the motivation. If you take that away from him, then you're taking away a core thing of Batman. Right. We were talking about this, too. There are some interpretations of Batman where I am Bruce Wayne and I go out and fight crime as Batman. That is my persona. And then there are others who are like, Bruce Wayne died that night, too, with his family. Mm-hmm. And he became Batman. And Bruce Wayne is now the persona he does as a means to the end.
Mm-hmm.
Both are legitimate interpretations, as far as I'm concerned.
And we've seen that played out with the different actors, the different stories that have been told.
Right.
And what is the case with Adam West's Batman? Is Bruce Wayne the mask? Is Batman the mask? Or is it somewhere between?
I don't think Bruce Wayne is the mask. I really don't. One thing that many Batman fans know watching the 66 series is that when Batman is down in the Batcave, he never takes the cowl off.
Mm.
Burt Ward, Robin, Dick Grayson never takes the domino mask off.
Yeah.
They are always in that character.
Yeah.
And when they go upstairs, they're Bruce Wayne, except for rare occasions where they need to be Batman and Robin and such, whether they're visiting Aunt Harriet, wishing her happy birthday or something like that. In fact, there's only one instance where Bruce Wayne is in the Batcave as Bruce Wayne while Robin is there. He goes down there because he's like, he wanted to tell Robin something, and then he's like, you take care of this, I'm going off as Bruce Wayne.
Wow.
But when I always do find it interesting when he says, I'm going as Bruce Wayne, then you have to wonder, you know, that's like saying I'm going as, you know, Superman to a costume party. Yeah. No, you know, you're not just saying, I'm going. Yeah. You're saying, I'm going as Bruce Wayne.
As if it's a character.
As if it's a character in itself. It's moments like that you wonder, is Bruce Wayne the character, and Batman is really all there is to him there as well?
I think that points to the reality that it's a show with surprising depth.
Yes.
There's more layers to it than maybe at first you would assume. Mm-hmm. I think maybe Jim Beard said it in that introductory chapter. I can't remember. Somebody said, you know, a child could watch it and enjoy it and then grow up a little bit and as a young adult watch it again and be like, oh, wow, there's a lot more going on here.
Oh, yes.
You know, could you tell us a little bit about that? Like, okay, it's an action show. It's a comedy, as you mentioned before. But what's the other stuff that's maybe going on there?
Well, for instance, for me as a kid, the action things. I mean, every time Batman would get into a fight, my brother and I, along with the music, would, wrestle along and fight as well and such. But growing up, and especially now doing the podcast, there are levels to it that just didn't occur to me at the time as a kid. For instance, 1960s television, you didn't see a lot of people of color on television unless they were in the background, like well in the background. Here on Batman, you have bankers, you have business people. Mm. You have, in the very first episode, at the very end, when Bruce Wayne is holding a party, and no, it's the second episode, I apologize, it's the second episode, and Commissioner Gordon is explaining why Batman is dressed up as a bat, you know, and he says to instill fear in criminals and all that, and as he's telling the story, a couple walk in, very well-dressed, rich, you know, they're there at Bruce Wayne, black, and it's like, wow, to me, as a kid, I didn't connect. But as an adult, I'm going, wait a minute, there's more to this here. They worked in, you know.
There was an intentionality.
There was definitely an intentionality. There's other moments there in the show, Native Americans. There's an episode where Egghead works with this Native American who holds the lease to Gotham City.
Okay.
And every couple of years, the three richest men in Gotham City, the three founding fathers, are supposed to pay him 24 raccoon pelts.
Wow.
And if they don't, the whole city reverts back to him because he's the last remaining member of his tribe and stuff like that. And there are moments where, and it's funny because MeTV, which runs the show, wasn't running it for a while because they thought it was offensive. But I'm like, you miss the point of it. Because, there are those goofy moments like when Batman goes to meet him and they do a whole hand signal thing and it's funny and silly and some people might say offensive and such. And I can understand that. But then there's also a scene later on when Batman and Robin are in the Batcave and he's talking to Robin and telling him the story. He goes, do you know why the chief is always so annoyed at people and such? He goes, because one day he was walking along and someone yelled at him, hey, you, go back to where you came from. And Robin looked and goes, but this is where he came from. He said, exactly.
Wow.
You know, things like that, you know, on Batman, the levels to this day, there's an episode called His Honor the Penguin, in which Penguin runs for mayor. It sounds so ridiculous. Yeah. But when you watch the campaigning, when you watch, there's a debate scene, it's still reflective of how we are with our election cycles here in the United
States. Maybe more and more so
every
election
day,
we have.
I know. It's just the craziest thing that on those levels, as a kid, I totally missed it.
Yeah.
Totally missed it.
Yeah.
But as an adult, and it's interesting to note, because I say, you know, people of color being well represented, it isn't until the third season that we have our first villain.
Catwoman.
Eartha Kitt playing Catwoman as the villain. Mm-hmm. They're always upstanding citizens and such. And it's funny because we went through three actors playing Mr. Freeze.
Mm-hmm.
And I can distinguish which ones I liked and which ones I didn't like as a kid. We had two actors playing Riddler. Mm-hmm. And I can always say, you know, as a kid, Frank Gorshin was not John Astin, you know.
Yeah.
But growing up now, I can appreciate what John Astin did. But as a kid, for some reason, I never twigged on and said, wow, Catwoman's black. I just was like, she's Catwoman.
There's Catwoman.
She's just Catwoman. For whatever. Maybe it's also just because I was a boy and these were beautiful women and I was just appreciating. I don't know. I don't know what it was. But as an adult, especially now, again, and diving into history and seeing what Eartha Kitt went through in the 1960s because she spoke out against the Vietnam War, found herself blacklisted from a lot of entertainment. She actually moved to Europe for a number of years and performed there before she finally came back to America when, you know, kind of all was forgiven.
Yeah.
Batman was one of the few projects she did during that time, and they took her in, even though, you know, Hollywood was kind of turning its back on her.
Right. Very interesting. You mentioned there, you were talking about Batman giving kind of lessons, or Bruce Wayne giving lessons to Dick Grayson. Can you tell us a little bit more about that kind of like father-son relationship that developed there?
There was always, the running joke is always, you know, because Batman would say something, or Bruce Wayne would say something, and Dick would go, gosh, gee, you're right. Like, there never was an argument. He just, however Adam West would say it, however Bruce Batman would say it, Robin Dick would instantly just accept it. But there are times where, you know, for instance, I mean, there's a scene where they pull up in front of the museum and Robin's ready to go inside, Joker's probably inside, and Batman says, hold on, we got to feed the meter. I've got time for that.
Yeah.
And he goes, you don't understand. You know, in paying for the meter here, that helps to pay into the government, which then will then use it to help build roads and improve our infrastructure. We all have to pay our part. On one hand, it's corny.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, he's got a point.
Right.
This is why we do the things we do.
Yeah.
And that was one thing also with Batman. He was always telling us how to be, because he always would say that. He would address everyday people on the streets. Good day, citizen. Citizen.
Yeah.
How to be a good citizen.
Mm-hmm.
Even in the most recent, they did an animated movie where Adam West and Burt Ward, it was one of the last projects Adam West did before he passed, they reprised their roles. They did the voices of the, and there's a scene where, again, Robin wants to run across the street. It's faster. Let's cut through here. Because no, we go to the corner and we look both ways and we cross.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, gosh, you're right, Batman. You know, because you never know. You run out there, you get hit by a car. You know, he's always about good citizenship. And the show itself learned how to be better citizens because this was 1966 and we had that beautiful Batmobile and it was tearing across Gotham City and people wrote in and said, Batman's not wearing a seatbelt. The first couple of episodes, you didn't see him putting on the seatbelt.
Okay.
But soon after, you would see the seatbelts going on. They made it a point. Anytime the Batmobile was taking off, they would cut to the seatbelt. So even the show itself learned how to be better citizens.
Sure, sure. That's really interesting. I remember as a kid, you know, kind of going to street fairs or like the fireman's fair, county fairs, and people would bring Batmobiles from the show.
Sure.
People that had purchased them when the show stopped running and would bring them to display them. And I was always so fascinated. All the things they made and talking to the owners of the different things that actually worked. You know, there was a car phone in there. Mm-hmm. There's the flamethrower at the back.
Yep.
the parachutes.
The parachutes worked.
There's so much creativity in, you mentioned earlier, the booby traps or the death traps right. that they were stuck in, or in the car or in the Batcave. Can you tell us anything about kind of the creativity that went into all that, or the...
Well, when it came to the death traps, the producers were working off, especially in the first season, they were working off the comic books. Mm-hmm. In fact, you can pretty much point to any of the episodes, including the False Face one, where they at least took the character, even if they didn't take the basic idea, they took the character from the comic book. And the comic books, you got to remember, the 1940s, 1950s, were larger than life. They were huge. It's funny because people say the Batman television show kind of ruined the comic books. It was like, no, the comic books were actually doing a pretty good job of ruining Batman as it was, because Batman was kind of neutered a little.
Yeah.
There had been a huge outcry from parents and such that the comics were too violent. So Batman started getting goofier and sillier in many ways. There were issues, like I was actually just reading an old one from 1955 last night, in fact, where Batman and Robin were assigned by the city to be fire marshals. And so Batman designed a new Batmobile that had firefighting capabilities. So the front looked like the Batmobile, but the sides looked like a fire truck. And they'd go out with their fire helmets right. on and everything. And it was just these kind of weird types of stories. Or they were doing science fiction stories where Batman and Robin went into space and to other planets and such. So the artist who was doing the primary artwork for the comic book was a man by the name of, why am I blanking on his name now? I have it on the tip of my tongue and I can't think of it. And unfortunately, this author, Bill Finger, Finger. And I say that because many people credit Batman to one person and they're wrong. They say Bob Kane.
Yeah.
Bob Kane came up with the basic concept of Batman. But the fact is that many of the concepts, the Joker, Robin, that was all Bill Finger.
Yeah.
And it took many, many years before DC Comics finally acknowledged, because they didn't want to pay out two royalties. They were already paying out to Bob Kane. I mean, his name was on every single issue, even if he had nothing to do with it.
Yeah, but you do see now, if you pick up any of the newly published stuff,
yes,
it says created by Bob Kane, by Bob Kane with Bill Finger.
With Bill Finger,
so they are starting to honor that, which is a good thing.
And some of the TV shows do as well. And in fact, if you ever get a chance, I think it's still on Hulu. There's an excellent documentary on Bill Finger and the struggle to get him the recognition he deserved. His granddaughter, Athena, is in it as well.
Okay.
She talks a lot about
it.
But Bill Finger had a style where everything was larger than life.
Mm-hmm.
He, you know, if you go back and look at whether it's like Batman and Robin in a giant book, they took that right from the comic book and translated. There's an episode where Batman and Robin get translated into a giant. So they took what were actually normal aspects. And maybe, you know, it just seemed goofier because it's television.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact is that, frankly, the 66 television show is one of the best comic book adaptations out there.
For sure.
For that time.
Yeah. And I think it stands up even today. I mean, just having rewatched some of the episodes, all the elements are there. And like you said, so much of it is drawn from the comics. That history you were just talking about, all right, you started out with these, you know, pulp kind of stories in the 1939, 1940, 1941. And then Batman and Robin quickly get taken up into the war effort. You know, you see them kind of as propaganda for World War II and things. Well, when World War II ends, and like you said, the comic book code and all these different things that came into play that kind of neutered them in a way. Okay, now they're fighting aliens and these goopy kind of stories of the 1950s. The 1960s TV show, it does reference a lot, like a full breadth of that history.
Right.
And it is surprising sometimes just how, I think audiences today can look back on that show and be like, oh, look how silly it is, look how goofy it is. That's not a good representation of Batman. But then you watch the first episode and he talks about his parents being killed. You see these things that are referenced, that are there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just a fascinating thing. And then even today, you can see things from the show that are now even being referenced in current movies. Like you mentioned the episode His Honor, the Penguin His Honor. Well, in the 1992 Batman Returns, Penguin runs for mayor.
Yep.
You know, so there are things that get referenced from the show then later on.
Oh, absolutely. The first movie, the scene with Joker in the art museum, mm-hmm. where he defaces all the artwork, that's from an episode of Batman. He did the same thing too there. For that matter, you know, if there are fans out there who love Mr. Freeze, you wouldn't have Mr. Freeze if it wasn't for, well, you probably would at some point, somebody would have thought about it. But Batman 66, there was no Mr. Freeze in the comic books. There was Mr. Zero,
right,
who had, you know, this thing for cold weapons and things like that. They took that and they changed it around and made it Mr. Freeze. And from there, we get the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie eventually with him there.
Right. Let's talk about that just for a second. Sure. I think a lot of people, they go back and they criticize a Batman and Robin movie. But in some ways, there's some of the fun and some of the kind of, right, these are just two guys, you know, Bruce Wayne and Dick Grayson, who are having a good time mm-hmm. fighting crime.
Right.
And that movie somewhat captures some of that. Maybe it was a bit silly when compared to the movies, three movies that came before it, and it just didn't fit in with that. What do you think happened there?
I look at those are the Tim Burton and
Joel Schumacher
movies from the late 80s and through the 90s and such. And actually, I look at those films as following the same path as the 66 series. If you really think about it, look at the very first movie with the Joker and such.
Yeah.
It's a bit more somber. The lighting is darker. Batman himself is a bit more serious. He doesn't come right out with the jokes and such. If you look at the first season of Batman, very cinematic. Most of the time they're out at night, you know, doing things. I mean, there are daytime shots and such. Then we move into the second season and things start to get a little sillier. Now they're making more jokes. You get to the second movie, you get to the third movie, it's getting a little more lighter and a little more, Joel Schumacher's taking over. I look at the fourth movie as basically the third season of Batman, because then it became off-the-wall bonkers with all the kind of crazy, because the third season also, there are really not too many great episodes. They're fun, but they're not great. They don't stand out compared to what you see where every episode of the first season pretty much hits it out of the park.
Wow. Yeah. Do you have a favorite episode?
Overall?
Yeah.
Overall, I am very fond of, in the second season, there's a three-part story called The Zodiac Crimes, which was done on the one-year anniversary of the show. And it has Penguin and Joker teaming up for this whole scheme with the Zodiac, where Joker is stealing things based on the Zodiac Crimes.
Wow.
And it ends with the two of them and seven henchmen who somehow managed to all fit in Batman's trunk of his Batmobile. And Batman knowingly takes them back to the Batcave because he wanted to try out, he doesn't refer to it as this, but he wants to try out his new DNA scanner because he's analyzing their entire body patterns, retinas, everything, so that he could have it for his crime file. And he tells them, the equipment is too big, so I needed to bring you into the Batcave to do it.
Wow.
And then, of course, it leads to an all-out big battle, which every episode of Batman does. But this one even more so, because you've got nine villains, Batman and Robin, in the Batcave.
In the Batcave,
knocking around. And they're climbing up the atomic pile, and they're jumping, knocking people. And it's just great fun.
Yeah, that sounds like great fun.
Yeah.
Now, this is the first book based on the first season.
Right.
The episode you just referred to is in the second season.
Yes.
Are we going to see a second season book?
And yes. There is
any hopes to write the chapter for that
episode? I've actually
submitted
my essay. It is not on Zodiac Crimes. I can't reveal yet. I've been told to hold off on revealing my portion of it. I'll just suffice it to say, as with the first season, I'm taking on a villain who didn't get a fair shake and only appears once in the series.
Similar kind of historical.
Historical look at the character and the actor who played this particular villain as well. Yes, and making my case. Although I do also make my case in this particular episode because we're False Face. Most fans love the False Face. Most fans are not big fans of this particular villain. So I make the argument why he deserved better and is actually a better villain than people give him credit for.
We've given us a lot of clues.
Yes.
I'm going to have to think who this villain could be, and maybe some of our viewers will too. Mr. Drew, this was a lot of fun.
It was a lot of fun. Thank you.
It gives me a chance as a priest to talk about Batman, which I don't get a lot of chances to do. It was a lot of fun, and I hope we can come back for season 2's book
that would be
when that comes out.
Yes.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much.